Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. My name is Jackie. Today I'm going to be doing a book review on The Mist of Avalon by Marion Zimmer Bradley. This is a fantasy romance. This book does contain sex, rape, incest, threesomes, murder, and suicide, along with a lot of betrayals. So technically The Mist of Avalon is a 4-book series, but you can buy them all as like one giant book, or as I did, as I listened to them on Audible. It's free right now. It's a really long book. It's 50 plus hours of reading or listening. So if you like something that's really in depth and is kind of a lot of bang for your buck, like, this would be a good book. This is also a story that spans between 50 to 70 years-ish. Now, if you're familiar with King Arthur or Camelot, like that whole spiel, I'm not gonna really be giving anything too crazy away. So if you feel like I'm giving a lot of spoilers away, I'm probably not. Again, this is a massive book and like a long book series. I mean, the series itself or the books themselves is really big. So even if you feel like I'm probably giving a lot of spoilers, realistically, I'm probably not. Also, just as a side note, you only follow the women involved in either Avalon or Camelot. You don't follow like any of the men. So when you start off reading, you're following Egraine. Egraine is Morgaine and King Arthur's mom. Egraine is married to one guy in the beginning of the series. I can't remember his name. And her sister, one of her sisters, her oldest one, who is Vivian, who is the Lady of the Lake. She is the high priestess there, and they follow like the Holy Mother. They don't follow God or Jesus or anything like that. They follow the mother, okay? Egraine also has a little sister, Morgause, who lives with her in the beginning. Now, I got confused in some parts because of Morgaine and Morgause, and I was just like, who is this again? Which one? So, Morgause is Egraine and Vivian's youngest sister. Egraine, at this time, gave birth already to Morgaine. When Vivian came to visit and told Egraine that her current husband is going to die and then she's going to marry the soon-to-be new king that like nobody knows about. Now, originally Egraine doesn't follow the beliefs of Avalon very closely. So when Vivian starts telling her this, she's just like, my sister is just trying to put like these false thoughts in my head. It's not a very like Christian-like thing to think and this and that. So she's just like, I don't believe it. I don't believe it. Until a series of events happens and she ends up doing it anyway. This is how she gives birth to Arthur. And Vivian can tell that Morgaine has the sight. So she can kind of see into the future or the past. Like, she has these magical abilities. So she talks Egraine into giving her Morgaine, because Vivian has no daughters to become the Lady of the Lake or the High Priestess. Egraine does agree, kind of not really necessarily reluctantly, but she doesn't show a ton of love to Morgaine. So it's almost like no love loss when she leaves, because Egraine gives a lot of love and affection to her new current husband and not necessarily a lot to her children. Like, even when Arthur gets older, she lets Arthur like leave and go be a foster child to another family. Years pass, and Morgaine has been told she needs to remain pure and remain a virgin so that when the mother calls upon her, she can do her due diligence and duty. Before she does that, she ends up meeting Lancelot, who is one of Vivian's sons, so it's her cousin. And she has the hots for him. And she just continually talks about wanting to be with Lancelot and like sleep with him and give him his first time and is envisioning like this life together. Just a reminder, Morgaine is not allowed to sleep with anybody. She is supposed to be saving herself for a specific purpose. Just she doesn't know what the purpose is. While she is hanging out with Lancelot in Avalon, this is where they end up meeting Guinevere. Guinevere is staying not in Avalon, but really close to Avalon at like a commune, I think is what it's called, where she just goes there and she's basically there all day, every day. Guinevere, I'm talking about. Is there all day, every day, just praying and being kind of like a nun, but not a nun. When they meet her, Guinevere is super rude to Morgaine, so Morgaine instantly doesn't like her. She's nice to Lancelot, and again, Lancelot is like super hot and attractive, so I guess the way it's kind of written, Lancelot is kind of smitten with her right away. And Morgaine is jealous and upset because he was acting like he loved Morgaine, which again, they're cousins. But he was really flirtatious with Morgaine and kind of leading her to believe that something might happen between them. But when Guinevere came into the picture, Lancelot kind of fell head over heels for her. Now, during this time, there is a stag hunt that is happening, which is where a man is to run through the woods and kill a stag. And it's supposed to be symbolic in Avalon that he's going to be like the next ruler and he's going to be kind of like the symbolic male figure for Avalon, because no man rules Avalon, only women rule Avalon, but this is like their male version of their king to a sort of degree. So Morgaine is notified or told that the stag, the king stag, is the person she's supposed to sleep with and lose her virginity to. So in her brain, she really wants it to be Lancelot. Like, this is the person she wants it to be. Everything happens. There's schnoo schnoo at the end of the night. It's so dark. She can't tell what this person looks like. On top of that, they have like blue or black paint or something on them, or ash. So it's just, it's too dark. They're both dirty. So they can't see who each other is. In the morning, when she wakes up, she's happy with the situation. She's feeling good. You know, they're holding each other. And then when they're talking, they realize, like she realizes that she slept with Arthur, who is her half-brother. And Arthur, even though he hasn't seen Morgaine in like 10 plus years, he recognizes her. Because when they were younger, Morgaine took care of Arthur a lot. Like, she would sing to him, hold him, make him feel better. So they basically find out that they're right away. And they're both upset. Arthur did tell her that he would always love her because that was his first, or she was his first.
So it just didn't matter that he would still love her. They go their separate ways. Morgaine finds out she's pregnant by him. And she thinks about aborting the baby. She thinks about giving the baby away to the fairy queen. And she ends up deciding that she's going to run away from Avalon. And she's going to go to Morgaz, who is her aunt, who is married to a lord. Or another king or something. And then Morgaz will be the foster mother to Morgaine's child. Again, this is over, like, what, a book one and book two? There's a lot, okay? So you have those things going on, and then once, it's crazy. Like, once Morgaine gives Morgaz her baby, or, like, doesn't see her baby, she bounces. Which, as a mom, that's wild to me. To be able to go 16, 18 years without seeing your child, like, once. That part really bothered me. But I digress. So you have all that going on. You kind of get the viewpoint of Vivian a little bit. You also get the viewpoint of Guinevere, which I will say, Guinevere is probably the most annoying and insufferable female character I have had to read or listen to in a super long time. I just find Guinevere's character to be very narrow-minded, opinionated, and I hate to sit there and be like, she didn't know her place, because that sounds terrible. But she just was a biatch, and it drove me crazy. And it was weird, because she was jealous of Morgaine, hated Morgaine, but then loved Morgaine at the same time. And she loved Arthur, but she also loved Lancelot. And that whole love square, triangle, hexagon going on between Lancelot, Arthur, Guinevere, Morgaine, and Kevin. Kevin is the new Merlin, just to be clear. I don't know. A lot of the story was about Morgaine, her viewpoints, and Guinevere's viewpoints and stuff that was going on. Morgaine doing what the mother wants, but then also not doing what the mother wants, trying to find her place in the world, starting a new life, getting married. And it's weird. It's like this back and forth between if she's going to be greedy and try to become the queen, if she can influence her brother, can she influence Lancelot, getting revenge on people, trying to have, you know, people murder other people. In general, though, I thought it was a good book. My mom was my age when she read it. So I was like 3 or 4 when she read it. This was like 30 years ago. And I'm reading it literally at the same age she read it as. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to read the book to begin with, is because it was a book my mom read. And I remember seeing her reading it when I was in high school as well. I did enjoy the book. It was really sad, like, certain characters die, and I think because of how long the book series is and you get so attached to them, you really feel the deaths of these people. And as a whole, I think it ended well and it wrapped up nicely. It does go into a great amount of depth between the Mist of Avalon, like the people living there, and their spiritual connection to, like, the earth and the mother, and a bunch of the Christian or Catholic people being against them because they believe in a god that's not their god. And all that back and forth is throughout the entire book series as well. And it just adds a bigger dynamic to the series as a whole. So if it sounds like something you would like, I would highly recommend it. I would say that I personally think it's a book that's probably more for women than for men, just by the way it's written. We tried to do it as a buddy read, me and my friend Wade, and he just couldn't get into it. And I think that's why, like, I think it's more written towards a woman's viewpoint or what women might like to read instead of men. That's a personal opinion, okay? But I appreciate you guys watching, and I hope you have a wonderful day, and I'll see you guys later. Bye, everyone.